sacrifice we have.
You're on.
As I look around that at the island here, and thank you all for coming. Thank you also to Stuart and to Judy for the meaningful tefillah project. I think tefillah often gets short shrift because it really is so hard for us to relate to on a consistent basis. And I thank Shomri for this opportunity. So as I look around at this island, I think some people will be more familiar with the sources, and if you're learning less intellectually because you've already done the sources, hopefully you will glean some inspiration from what we're going to talk about today. We don't think much about the Hallel. We don't think about where it came from. It's like, oh yeah, it's Yontif, we gotta have the Hallel. Oh, it's Rosh Chodesh, I better give another 10 minutes to Hallel and Musa. And Hallel is one of the glorious prayers that we say. If I speak enough about tefillah, you'll hear me say that about every tefillah. But today, Hallel is one of the most glorious prayers that we say. We are so busy often asking HaKadosh Baruch Hu for things, right? The entire middle of the Shemona Esrei, the weekday Amidah, is all bakasha. God, I want this. God, I need that. Hallel, with a very short exception inside it, is praise. That's what Hallel means. We are praising God. Halleluka is from the same derivation, and interestingly enough, there is only one sefer in which the word Halleluka appears, and that is Tehillim. It appears nowhere else in the Tanakh, and even in Tehillim, it doesn't begin appearing until the end of the fourth sefer. In case you're not familiar with this, Tehillim is actually five different svarim that some people say are parallel to Bereshit Shemot VaYikra B'Midbar Devarim, and towards the end of the fourth sefer, all of a sudden the word Halleluka appears, and then it keeps repeating itself over and over and over again in the fifth sefer, which is why sometimes the fifth sefer of Tehillim is called Sefer Halleluka, because that's where the word appears. Afilu, the word, even the word Halleluhu appears only in Tehillim, with two exceptions in Sefer Yirmiyah, in Perek Chaf in chapter 20, and Perek Lamed Aleph in chapter 31. So when we are talking about praising Hashem, this is it. This is the quintessential prayer of Hashem. So what we're going to do today is we're going to take a walk through how Hallel came to be in its form, where the laws governing Hallel, how we say Hallel, when we say Hallel come from, and then the next two times we're really going to delve into the poetry of Hallel, because Hallel is poetry. It is beautiful poetry, said in probably a better way than any of us could write ourselves if we chose to praise Hashem in our own words. As we're going to see, recitation of Hallel goes back to between 2,000 and 3,000 years ago. That's the other thing we don't think of. The Siddur is an ever-changing book in Jewish life. So, for example, you know how we sing Yedid Nefesh on Friday night? When I was a kid, we didn't. I suspect when most of you were kids, we didn't. That's a relatively recent addition, right?
2 years ago, Shomri
did. And there you go. So the Siddur is constantly changing, and we forget how far back some of these tefillot go. That for 2,000 years minimum, because they talk about it in the Gemara, 2,000 years people have been saying Hallel the way we are today, all over the world. We are linked vertically and horizontally to Jews when we say Hallel. So what I want to do is a quick overview of Tfilat Hallel, and then we're going to go through the sources together, as I said, to see where it comes from. There are actually two, if you're sitting near an art scroll, you can just pull one out. Thank you. Shabbat, the Chag morning, we say what's called Hallel Hagadol, the big Hallel. The reason it's called the big Hallel is because as a single kapitel, as a single chapter, it's longer, essentially, than Hallel HaMitzri, which is the Hallel we're going to focus on today. What makes a tefillah Hallel? It is the pasuk, Hodu Lashem Ki Tov Ki Li Olam Chasdo. Thank God because he is good, for his kindness is forever. Only two places it appears, in Hallel HaGadol and in Hallel HaMitzri. So we say this every Yom Tov and Shabbat morning. If you turn to 632, that's where we get to the Hallel we're going to focus on today, which is called Hallel HaMitzri for a very good reason. Because the beginning of the second chapter of Hallel says, "B'tzei Israel mi Mitzrayim." That's Hallel and Mitzri, right? This Hallel is six parakim, starting with 113 and going through 118. And what we don't realize about the Hallel that is different in the Siddur, the Tefillah, than it is in Tehillim, if you go to Tehillim or a number of things. So, 113 is the paragraph of Halleluka, Hallelu Abdei Hashem, 114, B'tzei Yisrael, and Lo Lanu, which we skip sometimes, but it's actually the end of that kapitel. Then we go into 115, 1 to 11 is Lo Lanu, and that's what we skip sometimes. And Hashem Zechorani Yivarech is actually the second part of 115. 116, Ahavti Ki Yishma, on page 636, which we skip sometimes. And we're so kind when we say we're saying Chatzi Hallel, half Hallel. It's a whole lot more than half. But I guess it's easier to say that than Chelek Hallel or something. And the second part of 116 is Ma'ashiv. Then we come on 638 to the single shortest perek in the entire Tanakh. It is Alelu Es Hashem Kol Goyim Shabchu Kol Omi. That's the entire perek. And we could talk about that one perek, very short perek, for 6 months to unwrap the meanings in it. Then we get to 118, which is the last one, which goes on and on and on until 640. The last words of the Hallel are Hodu Lashem Ki Tov Ki Li Olam Chasdo. That's the end of the Tehillim. Yehalelucha is an old addition, and we will see it goes really far back, the paragraph of Yehalelucha, but it's not part of the Tehillim. The other thing to point out is, we all know we repeat, right? So beginning with Odecha, Odecha Ki Ani Tani, Odecha Ki Ani Tani, that's not the way it's written in Tehillim. In Tehillim, there is no repetition. Each pasuk is written only once, and hopefully by the time we finish here today, we will see why we began doubling the psukim at the end of Hallel, even though that's not the way it was written by whoever it was wrote the Hallel, which we will explore. Anybody have any questions about the structure of Hallel? Okay. So we're going to go into the source sheets, and just for the sake of time, we're going to look at the sources in English, unless the original language is Shayach. It's important to understanding what the Mara or the other sources are saying. So what I'm going to do, so that you and I don't have to just listen to my voice this entire hour, is ask for volunteers to read English. Make it very easy. It's in English. And I may stop you along the way to explain certain things. Is there anyone who would like to be brave and volunteer to read source one on page one, which is Sanhedrin 94a? Ebby, thank you.
The Holy One, blessed be he, wished to appoint Ezekiel as the Messiah and
Sanhedrin
as God and Magad.
Okay, stop there for a second. Let me put this into historical context. This, by the way, is a pretty sad, about a sad story, but... But a very instructive story. Around the time of Yeshayahu, which is about 180 years before the destruction of the first Beit HaMikdash, Sancheirav and his minions camped outside Jerusalem wanting to capture Jerusalem. And in a miraculous feat, they all died overnight, and there was no siege on Jerusalem. Chizkiyahu was the king at that point. So the Agadata is starting out by telling us that Hashem wanted to appoint Chizkiyahu to be the Mashiach. And Sancheirav, who was the enemy, is Gogu Magog, who is the traditional enemy in the Armageddon, in the last great battle. So that's the context of this Agadata, yeah?
Whereupon the attribute of justice said before the Holy One, blessed be he, sovereign of the universe, if you did not make David the Mashiach, who uttered so many hymns and songs before you, will you appoint Hezekiah as such, who did not sing to you in spite of all the miracles which you wrought for him?
So HaKadosh Baruch Hu has his advisors, Kiviyachol, and Din says to him, Din Mishpat says to him, wait a minute, you did this for Hezekiah, you destroyed the entire army, and he did not thank you. How can you make him the Mashiach? Go on.
Straightway the earth exclaimed, Straightway the earth exclaimed, sovereign of the universe, let me utter song before you instead of this righteous man, Ezekiel, and make him the Mashiach.
So the earth is saying, I want the Mashiach to come too. Let me sing Shira for you, because clearly you saved me also. But?
So it broke into song before him, as it is written, from the uttermost part of the earth have we heard songs, even glory to the righteous. Then the prince of the universe said to him, sovereign of the universe, it, the earth, has fulfilled your desire for songs of praise on behalf of this righteous man. But a heavenly voice cried out, it is my secret, it is my secret.
That means I'm not changing my mind. Chizkiah didn't sing Shira to me, and that's what it says. Lo amar Shira lefanecha. Chizkiah didn't sing Shira, it's my secret. Who will be the Mashiach and when the Mashiach will come? That's why it's so heartbreaking. With a little Shira, a little Hallel, because Hallel is Shira, we could have had the Mashiach, and we didn't because we didn't sing Shira.
So who's the one crying out, it's my secret?
HaKadosh Baruch Hu is saying, it is my secret who the Mashiach will be and when. It is now my secret. Because obviously it was known, right? That's why the Agadata says this. We can actually stop there because this is really the crux of it. It is Shira. We are obligated, morally, if not halachically, to sing Shira to Hashem. Personally, that's why I think the entire Hallel should be sung out loud. I know there are people who want to get home and to Kiddush, and when somebody sings too much of a Hallel, b'chule, I am just speaking from my own spiritual nature. From the first word to the last word, we should be singing Shira b'yachad if we are in shul. And if we're not in shul and we're saying Hallel at home, also, we should be singing Shira.
Like the Sfardim.
Like the Sfardim.
So
and as a matter of fact, the Sfardim repeat everything. So, God bless them. All right. Yeah.
I'm thinking that your reasoning for this is a matter of bringing Mashiach.
Yeah, among other things.
It's like a tool to help make it happen.
Absolutely. That's what the Agadata is telling us, that we have the power to bring Mashiach. And we have an obligation when something good happens to us, we thank Hashem. And that's, don't we teach our children that, right? You say please and thank you. Somebody does something for you, you say thank you. I think sometimes we are more likely to ask for something than to remember to say thank you. Parenthetically, that's one of the amazing things about Yahudu. Most religions have grace before meals. we are the only major religion that has grace applicable. When your belly is empty, you're going to ask God for stuff. But when your belly is full, it's really easy to forget to thank God. And bracha achrona is a dioraita. Yachalta v'sabato v'erachta et Hashem alokacha. A bracha rishona is only a dirabana. What does that tell you about Yahadut? We say thank you.
Well, I mean, Yahadut itself, the core, the cherish, that it's our core.
Right. A beautiful, beautiful. All right, so who wrote the Hallel? Barbara, I saw your hand go up. Do you want to read the second source?
Our rabbis taught who uttered the Hallel.
There are seven opinions. Number one.
Rabbi Eliezer said Moses and Israel uttered it when they stood by the Red Sea. They exclaimed, not unto us, not unto us. And the Holy Spirit responded, for my own sake, for my own sake will I do it.
Lo lanu Hashem, lo lanu. There's a question whether Shirat Hayam is the original Hallel or not, right? The song of the sea. Mm-hmm. Maybe yes, or maybe in addition to Az Yashir, all of this was sung, B'tzeit Yisrael Mitzrayim. That's opinion one. Two.
Rabbi Yehuda said, Yehoshua and Israel uttered it when the king of Canaan attacked them. They exclaimed, not unto us, etc., and the Holy Spirit responded, etc.
So if it was Moshe Badiyam, that was in the year 2448 to the creation of the world. It goes back 3,300 years. If it's Yehoshua, add 40 years to that. So it's still about 2,500 years ago, 2,400 years ago. As Yehoshua is doing Kibosh Ha'aretz, as Yehoshua is conquering the land so that the Israelites can settle it. Number three.
Rabbi Eliezer the Modaite said, Deborah and Barak uttered it when Sisera attacked them. They explained, not unto us, except that the Holy Spirit responded, for my own sake, for my own sake will I do it.
So remember, after Yehoshua dies, he doesn't appoint a successor. And then we have Shoftim. And Devorah, the Shofetet, goes out to defend the land with Barak. And according to one source, she is the one who said it. Number four.
Rabbi Eliezer ben Azariah said, Chizkiyahu and his companions uttered it when Sanherib attacked them. They exclaimed, not unto us, and the Holy Spirit responded.
Ah, now if you're listening carefully, you're going to say, wait a minute, I thought Chizkiyah did not say Shira. Mm. Two different midrashim, two different sources. Midrashim are just that, midrashim, and they sometimes disagree.
Rabbi Yehuda said, Hananiah, Mikael, and Azariah uttered it when the wicked Nebuchadnezzar rose against them. They exclaimed, not unto us, and the Holy Spirit responded.
So this is after the destruction of the first Beit HaMikdash, before Shivat Zion, before we return to Zion. This story appears in Sefer Daniel, which is the Babylonian / Persian exile. Hanani, Mishael, and Azariah are the ones that are put into a fiery furnace, and they come out unscathed, and they sing Shira.
Excuse me. The idea also after, I'm just thinking, after the destruction is a matter of like, thank you God that you didn't destroy us. You kind of put all of us through the fiery furnace. And
so you're bringing up a really good point that Hallel is a communal prayer. There are other prayers we say for individual salvation. Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah were representative of the entire Jewish people that Nebuchadnezzar was trying to destroy. Right, so it wasn't that they themselves came out, but they as representatives of the Jewish people came out. Yeah.
Rabbi Yosef from Babylonia said, Mordechai and Esther uttered it when the wicked Haman rose against them. They supplicated not unto us, and the Holy Spirit responded, but the sages...
Okay, so that's, we all know the story of Mordechai and Esther.
But the sages maintained, prophets among them enacted that the Israelites should recite in every epoch and in every trouble. May it not come to them. And when they are redeemed, they recite it in thankfulness for their deliverance.
So the last opinion really covers all of it. last opinion says, yes, Moshe said it, Yoshua said it, Hanani, Mishael, Azariah said it, v'chule, because every time God saves the Jewish people, we should say Hallel. And we're going to come back to that later in the question of 2 days in the modern era, where some congregations say Hallel and some congregations do not say Hallel. All right. Is saying Hallel a mitzvah?
Am I misreading this last sentence that Barbara read to read that it should be recited before and after salvation?
Recited every epoch. When they're redeemed. No, after we are redeemed, we recite it in thankfulness for the fact that we were redeemed.
Yeah, but if you read the phrase before that, it says,
in every episode where we're in trouble, after the trouble is over, then we should say hello.
So it's simply a thanks, not a prayer.
Because the only bakasha in there is Ana Hashem Hoshiyana, Ana Hashem Hatzlichana. That's what I said. It's a little, but the rest is really pure praise, pure hodah. Right? All right. Before you look at the next sources, let's see what this chevra thinks. Is Hallel? Is it a mitzvah to say Hallel? If you think yes, raise your hand. If you think no, raise your hand. If you think it's a mitzvah, is it a dioraita? Raise your hand. Is it from the Torah? Is it from the rabbis? It's a machloket. All right. So I did choose the minority opinion first, who's the smach, the sefer mitzvot katan, which is 16th century, 14th century, based on Rambam, who's 12th century. Somebody want to read the opinion of the smach? Volunteers? Yeah, Nancy.
It is a mitzvah to recite Hallel at specified times, as it is written, Devarim 10, He is your glory. And our rabbi said in Israel, 18 days and one night, and in the diaspora, 21 days and two nights.
So the smach believes it is a mitzvah because it says, and therefore, in Devarim, and therefore, you're obligated to recite the Hallel. All right, I saw another hand. Bertha, do you want to go into Bracha 14a?
Sure. Achi v'tana of the school of Rav Chiya, put a question to Rav Chiya. What of interrupting to give greeting during the recital of Hallel and the reading of the Megillah? Do we argue a
Kal v'chomer. How much more so? Much easier to say.
What is it? The origin of that word?
It's Latin. It's Latin.
I didn't learn that.
Okay.
That if he may interrupt during the recital of the Shema, which is a biblical precept, there is no question that he may do so during the recital of Hallel, which is a rabbinical precept.
Ah, so it is not the oraita according to the Gemara Brachot. Go on.
Or do we say that the proclaiming of the miracle is more important? He replied, he may interrupt and there is no objection. Rabba said, on the days on which the individual says the complete Hallel, he may interrupt between one section and another, but not in the middle of a section.
Which is interesting because it parallels the halacha of Kriyat Shema. Someone important is talking to you, comes over to talk to you between parshiot, between sections, but not in the middle of a section.
On the days on which does not say the complete Hallel, he may interrupt even the middle of a section. But that is not so, for surely Rab Shaba once happened to visit Rabina on one of the days on which the individual does not say the complete Hallel, and he, Rabina, did not break off to greet him. It is different with Rav Shaba because Rabina had no great respect for him.
I just left in that last line because anybody who thinks Chazal doesn't have a sense of humor, they have a sense of humor. As a matter of fact, so there is a machloket. Is it dioraita or is it a derabanan? And as we're going to see later on, it may be that only Hallel HaShalem as it is on the rest of the days. All right. We're going to get into a section now, which is Gemara logic. If you're used to learning Gemara, chick-chock. If you're not used to learning Gemara, I'm going to stop at each point of the logic, because it is a logic that will build on each other. Okay, so. Do we have someone who would like to read the next section? Thank you, Harriet.
There are 18 days on the bridge, and in the first week of the feast, the 8 days of the feast of Tabernacles, the 8 days of Hanukkah, the first festival day of Passover, and the festival day of the Feast of Weeks. In the diaspora, one praying individually completes the challah on 21 days. The 9 days of the feast of Tabernacles, the 8 days of Hanukkah, and the two festival days of Passover, and the two
So people who say we should get rid of Sveka Dioma, of the second day of Chag outside of Israel, because now, of course, we know what the right days are, this is an at least 2,000-year-old tradition. We don't do away with 2,000-year-old traditions, and Sveka Dioma is talked about not only here, but in other places in the Gemara, too. All right, so we now know that we say Hallel HaShalem, the complete Hallel, on 21 days where we live. Go on.
Why this difference, that of the Feast of Tabernacles, we complete Hallel on all the days, and on the Passover festival, we do not do so on all of these days. The days of the Feast of Tabernacles are differentiated from one another in respect to sacrifices due thereon, whereas the days of Passover are differentiated from one another in respect to the sacrifice.
So the first point that Gemara is making is when you have an additional sacrifice, you must say Hallel. But on Sukkot, they had a different sacrifice in the day of Sukkot, right? Think of the Musaf on Sukkot, and then there's a different. But on the days of Pesach, on all the rest of the days of Pesach, we say, so we still say the Hallel, but we only say the Hallel on a day when additional sacrifices were offered in the Beit HaMikdash. David, do you have a question? Yeah, it should be. It should be, or not differentiated from one another in respect to their sacrifices. That's why we say half Hallel the rest of the days of Pesach, but we still say Hallel because of those extra sacrifices. Right, exactly. Good.
Where's the not missing?
Right at the are differentiated from one another, it should say, or not differentiated from one another. Sorry about that. Thank you for picking that up. All right. So, the next question the Gemara has is, so Shabbat we have different sacrifices, right? We have Musaf for Shabbat, because what it's saying is any day there's Musaf. We have Musaf because it was the additional karbanot. So there is Musaf on Shabbat. Why don't we say Hallel on Shabbat?
Let it then be read on the Shabbat, that which is distinguished by its sacrifices. If Shabbat is not called a festival.
So it's got to be different sacrifices and something that's a moed, a festival. Shabbat is not a moed, it's Shabbat. So we don't say Hallel. But.
But.
So Rosh Chodesh is a moed, so why don't we say the complete Hallel on Rosh Chodesh?
New moon is not sacrificed as
sanctified
as to prohibition of labor.
Okay, stop there. There's no Isur Malacha. Only days in which there's an extra carbon, and that's called a moed, and in which you're not allowed to do the forbidden acts of work, there's Isur Malacha, that's when you say the Hallel, and that's why we don't say complete Hallel on Rosh Chodesh.
Then why do you do it on Hanukkah?
You are predicting the next section. Excellent. Okay, well, not the next section, two sections down. Let's start with then let Hallel be said.
Then let Hallel be said on the new year and on the day of atonement, both of which are called festival and are sanctified by
and we may be redeemed. And then again, this is when, you know, all the books are open. It seems a little premature for us to be singing Hallel on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. And now we get to Jennifer's question.
But there is Hanukkah, on which neither one nor the other condition of life in the Hallel is set.
There's no Isur Malacha, it is not a Moed, and there are no extra Karbonot. So, how do we say it on Hanukkah?
That is due to the miracle.
Ah, so because there was a Nes, and according to the seventh opinion of the Chachamim, any time God saves the Jewish people, you say Hallel, what would be your next question?
Purim.
Why not Purim, God? Bring up a very good question. On Hanukkah, what was the miracle? If you look at different sources, they are going to give you different reasons. So, Lumashal, if you look at Al Hanisin, which we say in the Amidah and Birkat HaMazon, what is the miracle of Hanukkah? Is it Nes Nigla or Nes Nisgal? or is it open? Masarta Gibarimiyat Kalashim Tbeimiyata Urim. That's a hidden miracle. That we, the little band of Maccabim, defeated the Greek armies. Maybe one of the miracles was the light, but there are those who believe that's a sort of de facto reason for celebrating Hanukkah. That Hanukkah was that we defeated the Greeks and we reestablished holy worship in the Beit HaMikdash, which had been defiled, right? So that it could also be a Nes Nistar on Hanukkah, a hidden miracle on Hanukkah. All right, let's go on to the last time. Yeah.
Question. Why, according to Nachum Bar Yitzchak here, where it says that it's only, it was only before the Kibush Eretz Yisrael, then why not by the Ovos if we ever have a situation where we, like when Avram went to war, things like that. Why didn't we sing Shira then?
Well, according to the Gemara, it wasn't even written yet. The earliest it could possibly have been written, the earliest opinion is Moshe Rabbeinu, right? And the Avos were still individuals. So if you're going to get technical about it, Avram wasn't the first Jew, he was the first proto-Jew. There can't be a Yahadut until Ma'amad Har Sinai. We're not an Am, we're a clan. So if it is a national salvation, Avram was still proto-Jewish and he was protecting his clan. There are those who even say they were only Israelites until Shivat Zion with Ezra when they became what we know as the Jewish people, because so many of the Gezerot that we know come from the era of Ezra. The Gezera against intermarriage, reading the Torah, Shabbat afternoon, Mondays, Thursdays, v'chule, v'chule. So it's Ezra and then the Anshei Knesset HaGdola, but Avram was an individual in that sense of the word. That's a great question. There is one other time we say Hallel that hasn't been mentioned anywhere, and that is Pesach, the Seder. Doesn't show up anywhere until now. And here is the reason that we say Hallel on Pesach. Oddly enough, it appears in Psachim 64a. Somebody want to read? It's an easy one. It's all in caps. Because it's the Mishnah. Thank you, Diana.
On Passover Eve, during the preparation of the Pascha offering, they recited the Hallel. If they finished it, they repeated. And if they repeated and were not finished yet, they recited it third time, though they never did recite it a third time. Rabbi Yehuda said the third division never reached. I love that word.
Hafti ki yishma Hashem. We don't give a second thought to Karban Pesach. And Karban Pesach was critical to the entire celebration of Pesach, the entire time that the Batei Mikdash stood, that the temple stood. So let's take a step back. What did they do? Remember, you're roasting the sheep, right? And you have all the people around you, and you're roasting your sheep for your Karban Pesach. Are you sitting around playing pinochle? Are you talking about how, Shprinz's burka is not so pretty because she should never wear bright green? I mean, what are you doing while you're roasting? You're singing Hallel. Can you imagine the scene? You are evoking the miracles of Yetziat Mitzrayim. You are doing this for God's sake. You know that you're going to get some good rack of lamb in a few hours. And you're singing Hallel. Now, imagine how long it takes to roast one of these Karban Pesach, right? If they never got to the third time, imagine how they were celebrating and singing the Hallel. That's what they were doing. So that when we sing the Hallel at the Seder, we should be invoking the memory of this is when the Hallel was sung on Pesach, when they were doing the Karban Pesach. That's going to change the time of Hallel, hopefully, because for most of us, by the time you get to Hallel, you've been through Maggid, you're hungry. If you've had a lot of discussion, it's 11:15, 11:30. You've had a little piece of potato and parsley, some matzah and maror. Well, you haven't even had the matzah and maror let's get through the hollow. No, let's not get through the hollow. Let's step back now after the Magid and say, Halavai, we would be bringing the Karbon Pesach and be allowed to say the Hallel while we're roasting the Karbon Pesach. Let us raise our voices and sing to HaKadosh Baruch Hu because we are sitting in our house. Hashata Hacha, Lashon HaHaba B'nei Chorin, right? But we are B'nei Chorin in the sense that we have the ability to gather, to have a Pesach Seder. How much more thankful can we be to HaKadosh Baruch Hu? Because if he hadn't taken us out of Mitzrayim, Kulanu Nevonim, Kulanu Chachamim, Kule, we would still be servants to Paro in Mitzrayim. Correct. No, the people were also saying the Hallel as they were doing the Karbon Pesach. Yeah?
So for Yom HaTzmaut, you wouldn't say it's the sacrifice is, it's not an Isser Malacha, it would be more like a Chanukah?
We'll get to Yom HaTzmaut, hopefully within the next 10 minutes. No, not the original one, the one they brought in the Beit HaMikdash. I think Rabbi Yehuda talks about the people who are doing the Korban Pesach. All right, we're up to Tanit, page 4. You want to read?
Thank you, Lisa. Let the Mishnah also state that there was no Ma'amad on the first of Nisan, because there was Hallel and Musaf offering and the wood offering. Rabbi replied, this proves that the recital of Hallel on New Moon is not a biblical injunction.
Ah, so can you now extrapolate from there that if the reciting of Hallel on Rosh Chodesh is not a biblical injunction, is not a mitzvah d'oraita, that the rest of them are? Maybe, maybe not. Okay, I want you to skip down a few lines because I want to make sure to finish on time. Go up to 4 lines from the bottom. Rav once came to Babylonia.
Rav once came to Babylonia and he noticed that they recited the Hallel on New Moon. At first, he thought of stopping them, but when he saw that they omitted parts, he remarked, it is clearly evident that it is an old ancestral custom with them. Atana taught, the individual should not deliberately begin to recite the Hallel, but once he has become, he should complete
it. It is minhag avotein hem biyadehem. So he said they've been doing this for so long that it has already become embedded into their culture, but they shouldn't have said it on Rosh Chodesh at all. Having said that, it's minhag avoteinu biyadeinu. It is a halacha today, certainly, that we say chatzi halel on Rosh Chodesh. Okay.
Well, why do we say a bracha?
Ah, we'll get to the bracha. See? Baruch shekivanta. I think we're going to skip the stuff on page 5, and because that's all about how we say Hallel on Seder night, so that's one night a year. Hopefully take these home, learn it on your own. It's some great sugyas. But let's go to page 6, the Shulchan Aruch. So now we're going to see what are the specifics for how we're obligated to say the Hallel. Does somebody want to read the Shulchan Aruch? Oh, Debbie.
Praise the servants of God who stand in the house of God. That is to say, Psalm 135, that is to say, praise God while standing. Since Hallel is testimony of praise of God, and his wonders and miracles that he did for us, and the commandment of testimony is done while standing, as it says in Baruch 19:17. The two men who have a fight will stand.
We say Hallel standing. It's not just because, oh, isn't this nice, and I can, you know, see the chazan who's leading the Hallel. I can see the na'an. No. We say Hallel while standing because it says Hallelu et Hashem v'amidah. So we say it standing. There's one other point, and I couldn't find the makar, so I didn't put it in here. I remember learning it, but I just couldn't find the marker. Maybe one of the smart people in the room can remind me where it is. You can say Hallel for the entire day, but only while the sun is up, because in Hallel itself, it says, Mimizrach Hashem Hashem Mavoh Mulal Shem Hashem. From the time the sun goes up until the time it goes down, we praise the name of Hashem. And I just couldn't find the makor. But we say Hallel standing, we say Hallel during the day, not at night, with the exception of
Pesach.
Pesach is a lot of exceptions. All right. Now, I included the next source from Encyclopedia Talmudic just be, yeah? So when you give testimony, you must be standing. So that is the halacha from the Torah, that when two people are giving testimony. Hallel is praise of the testimony of the goodness of the testimony of praise. Praise of the testimony of the goodness of Hashem. So we stand. So the next source just amuses me because it tells me what a practical people we are. Does somebody want to read the Encyclopedia Talmudic? I really like this source. So I just said we stand, but on Pesach we read it seated.
Since we divide it into two, we do not require one to stand. And also because if he was standing at his table with his cup in his hand, perhaps he will become distracted because of the wheel, and the cup will fall from his hand.
We are indeed a practical see that the Hallel of Seder night is really a different inyan than the rest of the Hallels, and that could take its own shear.
Well, you could also, if you're standing, you've got
what do you do with great points? Because
it's the third
class. On an empty stomach.
You have a point, too.
That's right, that's true. Yeah, you can spill on the matzah, and if you don't hold by the Bronx, that's off to the bay. We are truly a practical people. All right, let's go on to the next halacha, which is from the Mishnah Berurah. Nancy?
The mourner does not say Hallel, since in it it is written, this is the day that God made, let us rejoice and be happy.
Zeh hayom asah Hashem nagila v'nismachavo. If somebody, lo aleinu, was sitting Shiva, can they truly say, Zeh hayom asah Hashem nagila v'nismachavo? Afilu the pasuk before that, ve'et Hashem haitazo v'hi niflat v'yeinenu, from God, this has been wrought, it is wondrous in our eyes. Frankly, most of us would be lying if we felt this way when we are sitting Shiva. And so, because of that, it's got to be an honest, authentic tefillah. The Avel does not say Hallel. Now, there's a machloket whether Hallel is said in a Shiva house or not. So there are those who say it is said in a Shiva house, but only if it is not the house of the Niftar. There are those who say it is said, and then the Avel leaves, and there are those who say, you just do not say it in a Shiva house. After you finish, remember you can say it the rest of the day, you say it somewhere else other than the Shiva house, out of sensitivity for the Avel, who number one, has to leave their own room, right, because they can't say Hallel, and you're still in the house of an Avel saying Zeh Hashem, Zeh Hayom Asah Hashem.
You refer just to the week of Shiva.
Yes.
Not Shlosh.
No. When it says the Avel, it means the week of Shiva.
That's interesting because most Shiva is ended by Yantif.
But not Rosh Chodesh. It's Rosh Chodesh, that's the question, not Yantif, because you're not sitting Shiva on Yantif. You're absolutely right.
But also,
Rosh Chodesh
is the
question.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's only during the Shiva.
Okay, so now we get to the question of the brachot. The question of the brachot is, oh, we got 2 minutes left. The question of the brachot is, why do we say bracha and chatzi halal? So this is the original from Machzor Vitri, which is the oldest extant machzor that we have with the halachot of the various tefillot. And in Machzor Vitri it says, on days that we recite the whole halal, we say, Asher k'dushan mitzvotav v'tzivanu ligmor et ha-halal, to finish the halal. And on the days that we recite half halal, we say likro et ha-halal, to read the halal. Nobody does that anymore. But in the olden days, that's the way it was done because they wanted to differentiate between when it was a mitzvah, either a deoraita or a derabanan, and when it was either a derabanan or a minhag. That has fallen out of use. I don't know anybody who does it anymore. I don't even think the Eidot HaMizrach do it anymore.
I think the only thing in some mitzvahs, they the half halal, only the chazan says the bracha, and everybody makes his own main, and nobody else says the bracha.
That's, but it's still the krot halal, right?
It's still
not
the
krot
halal.
Hannah, you had a question?
Yes. If you want to praise
Karati Ka Anani b'merchavka, that is a repetition. Li Hashem li is a repetition. Tov lachso, tov lachso, tov lachso Hashem, right, is repeated. So vavuni, sabuni, gam sabavuni is repeated. Dacho dechitani is repeated. Vahili lishua, kol rina vishua is repeated. Yamin Hashem asachayil, yamin Hashem ramema is repeated. Lo amut, ki echia v'yasefer mazdeka, ulamavet lo nitanani, that is the similar words, but definitely the same idea. Pitfu li shar tzedek, open me up, the gates of righteousness, etc. And then the repetition stops. The poetic repetition stops. So Rashi says, we put in the poetic repetition, right? Whether it's for emphasis, whether it's for, you know, how do you limit Zahayom Asah Hashem Nagila Nismakava to one time? Once you said it once, you're like, yeah, I agree with that. Zahayom Asah Hashem Nagila Nismakava. And therefore, we repeat from Odecha Am. Big overview. Next time, as I said, we will go into the words themselves. Questions, comments? Yeah.
Since we said here that Hallel is a group and it has to be done to people, does that mean that if you're davening the Yechidus that you would skip Hallel?
No, because it's we can have our own personal Yechidus. People say that Shema is a Yechidus, right?
Mm-hmm.
We say Shema by ourselves.
Okay.
We say Shema by ourselves. We can say Hallel by ourselves. Same kind of thing.
Okay.
Well, yeah, it can be. Testimony. So when we say Shema, we are testifying to the world that we believe that God is our God, and we believe God is one. It's why so often when you're in shul, you hear people saying the Shema louder than under their breath, because there is an idea, it's supposed to be heard by others. It's for me, but it's also for everyone around me, because I am testifying that I believe in God. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Maybe that's why Spore is different.